local acquisition and broadcast of Robin Hood is made possible in part by Mercy Theaters, a subsidiary of Yakima Theaters Incorporated. The deaths of more than 100 Mexican soldiers and police in the last 18 months prove its war on drugs is taking a significant toll in human lives. But an expanded military effort to combat drug trafficking is proof Mexican President Carlos Salinas de Gortari has given his country's anti-drug initiative the highest priority. We'll report on the latest initiatives and the new spirit of cooperation between Mexico and the United States on the drug issue. Welcome to Update Mexico.
Well, the Mexicans are making substantial efforts today to combat exports of drugs into the United States and other North American countries. They are putting more of their resources, the law enforcement effort on this. They're putting more along the border. But perhaps most important of all is just a change in attitude, a change of much greater cooperation with the United States and with other law enforcement agencies.
Vice President Dan Quayle noticed the new attitude on a recent trip to Mexico.
Mexico is a friend. Mexico is a neighbor. One of the reasons that I'm here today is to show the strong importance that we attach to the relationship with Mexico. President Salinas and I both concurred on the importance to continue the war against drugs. He indicated that there should be new rules of understanding between Mexico and the United States on drug cooperation.
Cooperation has improved since President Salinas declared war on drug cultivation and transportation.
We will never cease in fighting day after day, combating drug trafficking, which is the modern cancer of our societies.
President Salinas has authorized an expanded role for Mexico's military, launching a national Air Force operation against drug trafficking, which includes aircraft, helicopters, and ground vehicles. Colonel Victor Ortiz Berman is head of the Mexican military's Anti-Narcotics Special Operations Force.
The Mexican Army and Air Force are collaborating on drug eradication. The Air Force searches for the fields, then the Army goes in locally, destroys the fields, makes arrests, and then turns the suspects they've captured over to the proper authorities.
The new operation includes 10 air bases, strategically located along the border, with a central base controlling all operations. The force utilizes information obtained from U.S. radar located along the border, part of a coordinated effort which includes airspace vigilance provided by the U.S. Navy and Customs Service. Congressman Jim Colby says the significance of an increased military presence along the border could reduce the flow of drugs into the U.S.
The significance of having the Mexican military involved in the war on drugs is it brings a resource that hasn't been available in as large a way as before. Having them directly involved in this fight, whether it's engaged in air interdiction, whether it's going in on the spraying, whether it's going in on the ground and burning up marijuana fields, that could be a very important part of this effort. And I think it's a hopeful sign, it's a good sign that the Mexican government has decided to commit its military to this fight.
One of the most important facets of the Mexican military's war on drugs is its Marte task force. Task force troops devote their time to inspection, plant destruction, cutting off the transportation routes of traffickers, and arresting suspects. This permanent campaign has become a regular activity for all Mexican Army and Air Force units, whose basic training includes the recognition of drugs, mobilization, and reconnaissance of drug plantations.
The Special Task Force, Marte, is 3,000 men, and we have approximately 14,000 soldiers involved daily in the whole republic, mainly in the areas of the most conflict.
The expanded role of the military has generated results. More than 85 tons of cocaine have been seized during the past 18 months. And for this expanded commitment to fighting the war on drugs, Mexico's Attorney General Enrique Alvarez was given the Spirit of Freedom Award by the American group Pride. The only other recipient of this prestigious honor was former First Lady Nancy Reagan.
In Mexico?
In Mexico, no one is above the law, and our big challenge is to combat with severity the problem of drugs.
Mexico itself has a relatively minor drug problem. New York City alone has twice as many addicts as all of Mexico. Mexico City's mayor said the government's anti-drug campaign, called ADEFAR, has kept the problem in check. Each block organizes meetings and hands out literature on drugs.
We find that this is the right strategy, it's working, and we are giving all the financial backing and technical backing that is necessary.
Mexico has enlisted the aid of celebrities and privately sponsored pleas to stay off drugs. Jose Luis Gonzalez, chairman of the National Advertising Council.
The National Advertising Council is strongly committed against the drugs. We are using celebrities in the TV commercials. We have three spots currently in the air, two against the use of drugs and one against the supply of drugs. Mexico is a young country. That's why we believe that the future of Mexico is in the young population. That's why we believe that we need to have a very healthy population in order to be a strong country in the future.
But perhaps these pictures more accurately depict the price Mexico pays for its war on drugs. More than 100 soldiers and policemen have died in the last year and a half, leaving behind sons like young Mario Lopez, whose father, a federal policeman, was brutally killed. But Mexico remains undeterred as it increases its military presence. Mexico's battle against drugs and its cooperation with the U.S. prove drug trafficking isn't just one nation's problem. It's everybody's war.
No matter what the outside of your toaster looks like, the inside hasn't changed much in a long time. As in many home appliances, including steam irons, waffle irons, and coffee makers, at the heart of the toaster, there's a very simple device. It's a bimetal strip, and here's how it works. If two different kinds of metals are bonded together into a single strip, and that strip is locked in place at one end, and then heated by running electricity through it, unequal expansion of the two metals will deform the strip in a predictable direction and by a predictable amount. When the bread is lowered, a flow of electricity is turned on, which heats the wires inside the toaster, which in turn cooks the bread by radiant heating. We can follow the workings of the bimetal bar in our toaster. When the bread descended, a release lever slid into place under the heat-up lever. Now the bimetal bar has begun to heat up. As it heats and deforms, its front end slowly slides to the left, past the bottom of the cool-off lever, which slowly moves into an upright position. At the same time, the tab attached to the bimetal bar pushes against the control lever, which was set to determine how well the bread will be toasted. The tab attached to the bimetal bar now pulls down on the back of the heat-up lever. The release lever slips up until it breaks the electrical connection to the bimetal bar. The release lever is now held by the cool-off lever. As the bimetal bar cools off, it straightens out again. This pushes the cool-off lever to the left, which frees the release lever, bringing toast to a hungry world.
KYVE Yakima would like to thank its viewer supporters in Kittitas.
Good evening and welcome to this week's edition of the Classic Theater. Tonight's movie is a comedy called Nothing Sacred. The stars are Carol Lombard and Frederick March, and it's directed by William A. Wellman, and it was a 1937 film. It's a classic comedy about a hotshot reporter who capitalizes on a Vermont girl's supposedly imminent death in New York City. And it was scripted by Ben Hecht, and the musical